Hello, with all listening in to our webinar on doing business in the Netherlands and transfer pricing. We introduce ourselves a little bit in a few seconds, but what we're doing today is giving you a high level overview of what's happening in the Netherlands at the moment, and specific on transfer pricing and also alignment with tax authorities. That's the agenda for today. So after a short introduction, we will go into the investment climate in the Netherlands. We will be very proud on our positions worldwide, so that's great, but also maybe give you some pointers there. After that, we are going to the transfer pricing developments in the Netherlands, a little bit on also Corona at the moment, because yeah, nobody can escape the virus at the moment, so keep safe. Then we go into the alignment with the tax authorities. We had some hiccups last year by changes, but that is now more streamlined again. So we'll go to what happened, yeah? And how to deal with the tax authorities and what are your choices. And we will end with some final remarks and Q&A. And I have to say that we had last week a webinar on the 15th of April. That is like this will be recorded, and the presentation will also be shared also on the 15th of April. And there we went very in the technicalities of transfer pricing. So this is something we not are going to repeat to that extent, but to help you, we will send you after this webinar the slides and the recorded webinar also from 15th of April. And please, if you have questions after the webinar or on the webinar on the 15th of April, please give us your question or reaction, and we will certainly get back to you as soon as possible. Yeah. Okay. This is on this field. We first have to thank also Peter Young. He's the chairman of the Time and Business Families in the south of the Netherlands. We had a nice talks with him. Personally, I have I'm working for a lot of Taiwanese companies. I really like the interaction between us and also with Peter. And when we first met, we had the thought of having a round table and or a bigger event in our office, but yeah, no, everybody can understand that it's not possible anymore. And then we discussed and agreed that maybe a good introduction webinar on transfer pricing and the Netherlands and Contea Global would be a very good alternative. I just heard that Peter had some difficulties to call in because he's obviously working from home. That makes it a little bit difficult. I don't know if he's in the call at the moment. Otherwise, we will see when he is able to join and then give the floor a little bit. But I don't think that he needs introduction, Peter, with you. So let's first thank him. Then I will go over to my co-host. That is Nart Donders. He is a bright young man with our company. And I'm very pleased that he was free for this webinar. And maybe you can introduce yourself a little bit, Nart.
Yes. Thank you to you. Thank you for the introduction. So indeed, my name is Nart Donders. I'm a junior manager at Contea Global. And together with Theo, I'm involved in various transfer pricing projects for Taiwanese multinational companies. The projects range from the preparation of transfer pricing documentation to setting up transfer pricing policy for newly established companies in the Netherlands, as well as obtaining alignment with the Dutch tax authorities. And considering that background, I will, together with Theo, co-host this webinar today. Maybe one addition to your introduction, Theo, I think all participants can also ask questions during this webinar. I think you all have the Ask a Question button on your screen. So please feel free to raise the questions, and we will try to respond to that during this webinar.
Yeah, and please do it interactive, and please give us your questions. We will try to answer them. If we can't answer questions, we will come back to you separately. But I hope that we can answer them in this webinar. Okay. Then maybe a short introduction on Contea Global.
Yes. Theo, maybe you can explain as the co-founder of Global, why you started Contera Global?
Yeah, sometimes I'm lying in bed, I think, and why that's
yeah.
true, because I had a background. I'm working for the Big Four and in the Golden Cage, and still we started in 2013 with Contera Global. I think the main reason was that we wanted to do it differently. We wanted to have a safe environment for colleagues and companies, and that we make them in control on TP and help them as we want to be supported ourselves. Mm-hmm. And that's possible when you're independent, you have a strong DNA, and you have a big retention on people, because that's the quality of the organization, that people stay with you and that you build quality together. And that is something which what we are doing now, and you are one of the examples of it, and that strong DNA and the way we operate, it gives us a lot of clients.
Yeah.
Today I had for a project a call with a client, a potential project, and I say the most important is that we communicate, that we know what we're doing together, and there's no at your side, no surprise, and that we in each phase of a project have a good understanding. That's the basis. Okay. Communication is key, and that's the most difficult thing there is.
Yeah, I fully agree.
Okay.
I think that in R&D, some reasons why clients choose Contera Global, yeah, and why they like to work with us.
And on the former page, there was our office where we're sitting at the moment.
Yeah.
So they were sitting at the moment around that above that green green thing outside, standing with the queue of Contera Global. Okay.
Yes. Maybe to add some of our promises, why our clients like to work with us. I think the first reason is that we make transfer pricing easier, faster, and cheaper. And we do that through our TP knowledge, together with our tools, databases, and we have developed a transfer pricing software solution that ensures that the clients that we can support our clients in an efficient and effective manner. The second aspect is that we also share a lot of knowledge with our clients. We do that throughout the project, of course, but we also have set up the Contera Global Academy. Most important one is that we create value for our clients, and that transfer pricing becomes a value driver of your business.
Mm-hmm.
And by saying that, I mean that transfer pricing should align with your business and your strategy, and we are really focused on that.
Yeah, and maybe to add on, also obviously see it, trying to optimize it by seeing the incentives possible.
Yeah.
It can be an innovation box, but it can also be that you have losses in one country and profits in the other, and they say that's maybe not the right answer.
Yeah.
And that we try to make it optimal. But that's all in that value drive, value creation.
Yeah, and also teaming up with the client, what you already said at the beginning. And the last one is that we have global presence. We have a network of alliances and Contera Global branded offices all around the world, and that enables us to serve our clients almost in all countries.
Yeah, like we have now a project with a big client, stock quoted around 50 countries, and mm-hmm. we can cover the countries they are all in, and so that's great. And obviously, we have a discussion there with what is the requirements, which country are important, and do you need an APA or ruling on it, but it is so small that you ignore it. But that's all in the communication. But we can support where they need us. Yeah, and that's important. Okay, that's Contera Global. Now we're coming into another area, and that's investment climate in the Netherlands. Why are you in the Netherlands? Maybe you're thinking of coming to the Netherlands. There are all kinds of some are scaling up activities, and they have a presence in the Netherlands, and maybe already in Europe. And now, but why did they came to the Netherlands? And why would you like to choose for the Netherlands?
Yeah.
Maybe Nacht, you can say something about that.
Yes, it's also already on this slide. The Netherlands is number one in Europe. That's maybe a bit positive, but it is actually a result of the Global Competitive Index ranking, which was published by the World Economic Forum. And of all countries in the world, the number four is the Netherlands, and the number one in Europe. I think that's pretty good for such a small country. But of course, there are some underlying reasons why the Netherlands has such a good position. I think it all starts with our geographic location. We are located at Europe's front door, in between three of the largest economies in Europe. And from the Netherlands on, together with our infrastructure, the seaport, Schiphol Airport, the highways, you are actually able to serve all the customers in Europe from the Netherlands, maybe within one day. In addition to the infrastructure and the location, we also have a skilled labor force with a high productivity and a lot of available skilled workers. More than some of our competitors. And the fourth point is that we also have a stable political and economic climate, and the Dutch government is also aware of the importance of this stable climate. Yeah. And we try to achieve a sustainable economic growth that encourages the foreign companies to invest in the Netherlands for the long term.
Yeah. You'll see that on the list still is not something on tax, but there's a next slide. Yeah. But that's also maybe the stable political and economic climate, and that we are seen as the merchants from Europe, that we came across almost all the countries in the world in the centuries. So we have also some connection with Taiwan in the past. So we really are connected there. And that's also the reason that the Netherlands is looking at how to be competitive also for tax. And that is a balance act in these times. And we are streamlining it at the moment. And we have very good new initiatives. And I think we are there to be competitive or stay competitive in that field. And may I say that also Taiwan is on the list, so also one of the top. So as also congratulations for that. I think that's great for such countries to be there.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe something on the next slide that is going into more the competitive tax environment.
Yeah. So one important aspect for the competitive index ranking, which was not mentioned on the previous slide, is the Dutch competitive tax environment. And some important aspects we will discuss on this slide. It's the first one is that the Netherlands has a quite professional tax administration. And by that I mean they have capable and experienced employees, and also try to operate in a transparent manner with the taxpayers. They are easy to approach for discussion on certain aspects, and also are willing to cooperate. And for example, in obtaining APAs, but that we will discuss that later on.
Yeah, but we are going into in the last part of this webinar on alignment with tax authorities. Yeah. And we'll see that there was some balance act. We had some formalities to cope with from international guidance, but that's something we are coping with. But that's really true. The Dutch tax authorities and the people want to really connect, understand you, and try to make the company thrive in the Netherlands, and that's the base way of looking at it.
A more specific item is the special tax regime for expatriates. I think you will be known with that rule. That's a so-called 30% ruling. It's actually a rule for skilled workers, foreign skilled workers, and it offers an allowance to employers to offer 30% of an employee salary as a sort of a tax-free allowance.
Yeah, meaning that our tax rate, which is less competitive, I know,
yeah.
is down with 30% for if you come to the Netherlands.
Yeah.
And as an example, I'm looking at a company that is has its presence in the Netherlands, ASML. That's a very big country in the Netherlands, also stock quoted, and I believe they have around 60-70 nationalities, and they have 5,000 to 6,000 people outside the Netherlands working here, and most of them have this special tax regime.
Yeah. I think that the third one is that we have a wide network of bilateral tax treaties. And these treaties, of course, allocate taxing rights and prevent double taxation. So that's one advantage, of course. The other one is that in a lot of of these Dutch tax treaties. They also provide reduced or no withholding tax on dividends, royalties, and interest rates. And that's also a very big advantage of the Dutch tax environment.
There's also a build up to the centuries going into the world as merchants.
Yeah.
We wanted to have a freedom in working with all the countries and trying to avoid items that could jeopardize the business. And therefore, we have a lot of tax treaties for centuries and trying to avoid things like withholding tax, what you said, but also there are a lot of agreement procedure in that when there is a discussion between countries about transfer pricing, that in a lot of countries they have to come together and solve the situation so that you don't have double taxation.
Yeah,
I think that's also an important aspect of it.
Yeah. And the last one is that we have a competitive tax rate. I think if you look at the competitive tax rate throughout the years and compare it with the past, it's now around 25% the maximum tax rate, but it was, I think you know it better than me, but it was around 30%.
I don't know, don't say when I started it, but it was 25 years or longer ago, and that time the tax rates were 35 to 38%.
Yeah.
And they're gradually going down, but there's now some guidance that the tax rate should have a limit.
Yeah.
And but we are going down to have two rates, 16.5% and 21.5%. Yeah? So we are going down that rate again, and we're highly competitive there.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And may I say, maybe to stress this point, I myself was now for 25 years in action on as tax manager of a stock quoted company, as a tax advisor with the DTA for 7 years. I was head of that APA team for a couple of years and before key member of the Dutch Knowledge Group of the Dutch tax authorities. The Big Four, I worked for 7 years in Kantia Global, so I think I can say that that really the Dutch tax authorities are can be teamed up with. And but the way you would like to do it, that's your decision. And I helped personally a couple of Taiwanese companies to the alignment and also successful in obtaining APAs last year. Okay. Although the hiccups that were there at the moment. Okay. Yeah. Now this is my slide, I think, Nachten. Yeah. Topics when investing in the Netherlands. Why is this on the list? Because we are transfer pricing specialists, and this is more. Now the reason is simple. I had a lot of and have a lot of discussions with the companies that are in the Netherlands or setting up something in the Netherlands or scaling it up, and they all ask me the question from what's the legal framework? Should I have a legal entity? What are the tax compliance rules? What is alignment with the Dutch tax authority? Adequate substances, what does they mean with it, etc. And also transfer pricing. And to be supportive, we said, let's have one shop window that we as the Kantea Global can help you. And then we can go into the items that are on the board here. So if you have questions on incorporation of a Dutch entity, BV, Chamber of Commerce, or to better set up need the bank accounts, how to deal with booking or administration or your payroll. The 30% rule is one of those, but also ongoing activities like transfer price documentation or design work in the setup. That's something we can help you with, and also the specific activities that can be restructuring. So it could be in a company in the Netherlands that are going to restructure yourself, or that you are planning to have activities outside the Netherlands, more expanding, and you want to have also maybe alignment with tax authorities on it, or valuation. That's also possible sometimes. That's all something which you can discuss with us, and then we see what is with ourselves and our partners, what is the best match, and that takes a lot of time of your way, and can give you the right partners in almost no time. And that's why we did this. And I think that already gave us a couple of nice contacts, and they were very pleased with it.
Yeah.
And we as well. Yeah. Okay. Now we're going into what our field is, transfer pricing developments. And like I said, we had a week ago a lot of technicalities on it. And may I say that that was a very fine webinar to do with all the techniques, but the bigger picture, and that's what's put in these slides, is something else. And the bigger picture is that I started transfer pricing in 95, that's some time ago, as head of a tax of a multinational. And that time I was asked, Theo, what's transfer pricing? Was asked by colleagues, tax manager for other multinationals, what is transfer pricing? And I must say that was also for me a route to develop and to experience, because transfer pricing in the beginning was very slim. It was more if you're the cost plus, your markup was okay. And if your head office charges were documented from head office to a subsidiaries, and that was almost a thing. But gradually, transfer pricing became more important, became compliance burden. We got the first documentation requirements in the Netherlands in 2001. Exactly 2002 it was in law. And there we had the first very slim documentation requirements, not what we have today. And it was very material in the sense that you could say, with yourself, just choose what you needed. But the real change came to BEPS. And BEPS is base erosion and profit shifting. That was after recession in 2008, 2012. The countries needed money, the treasurers. And the G20, that were the bigger countries in the world, said we need to have better guidance and rules. And it was the BEPS action plan. And that's something which Nacht can show you, because in 13 it was said to the OECD, who has the guidance, give the guidance on transfer pricing, please work on it and give better guidance and avoid that companies can do a lot of tax planning.
Yeah, indeed. And that started indeed in 2013, 2012, yeah. What you said, Theo.
Yeah.
And the final reports were then published in October 2015. And already what you said, it was 15 action plans, all focused on solving base erosion and profit shifting. And also with a lot of focus on transfer pricing. Some of the BEPS action plans focused on to make sure that transfer pricing outcomes align with value creation, and that we'll discuss later, but that also really put the focus on having adequate substance in your organization. Another important BEPS action plan was the transfer pricing documentation. So it started with a slim TP documentation, what Theo said, in 2001, 2002. But now we have the TP documentation that actually derived from BEPS. That's the master file, country by country reporting, and the local file. And on the one hand, that increased the compliance burden for M&Es. On the other hand, that also provided a lot of more information to tax authorities. And so the focus of tax authorities on transfer pricing is also increasing as a result of BEPS. And that's something that companies should really be prepared of.
And if you show that timetable here, that you see, because that's a small thing, because if you would have implemented here all the reports and all what happened, even on the European Union and other governments, then this was really a spaghetti of items.
Yeah, indeed.
This is the main message, I think.
It is the main message, starting by BEPS. Then it was updated in the OC transfer pricing guidelines that are the international accepted standards for transfer pricing, followed by many jurisdictions. So the impact of BEPS was then also covered all around the world. Then in 2018, also updated on the Dutch transfer pricing decree. But one important aspect to you that came later, that was the focus on intercompany financing,
yep.
So financial transactions, interest rates, how you should deal with guarantees. That was not addressed in the BEPS action plan because companies could not reach consensus on how to deal with that.
Yeah, the countries had a difficulty because how to deal with the interest rates and guarantees, and all around it is difficult. Because then you have to go to that field. But to our surprise, in February 2020, the guidance was there.
Yeah.
And we already had part of the finance team. You've seen what happened, the question reports, and everything goes up sky high at the moment, because also tax authorities are asking questions.
Yeah, tax authorities are asking questions. Also we have now some guidance, and there's now some consensus on how you should deal with that kind of transactions.
Yeah. And therefore also the remark below, transfer pricing is climbing down the P&L. Yeah. Why is that so? As I mentioned, the markup, the 5%, that was on the operating income. That you say a company that has production capabilities, let's say, should have a result that is aligned with third-party results. So if we have benchmarks, what would be the above their own cost, the markup, because that's the result they would like to realize. And then you look to third parties, because that's the comparison. And then you come to 5%, let's say, and then the operating income was down the P&L, of revenue, cost of goods sold, OPEX. Operating income should then be maybe 5% of your cost. And then it comes below it, you have the interest line. And in the past, the tax authorities had difficulty to address it, because it's a very difficult area of transfer pricing. But it is transfer pricing, because also when you have intercompany loans, then that is also transfer pricing. It is intercompany, and the word says it immediately. And therefore, climbing down now, also the interest line is addressed by arm's length principle. So, in your documentation, in your defense, and setting and testing, and that's below line interest, that could also be guarantees. And sometimes guarantees are not in the P&L, but they should, are now addressed. And that is a really a big change from the past.
Yeah. Yep.
And obviously all what we're now mentioning are as guidance of the international organizations like the OECD, Organization for Economic
Cooperation and Development.
Thank you, Nach. Therefore, we need Nacht, thank you, great. But it has to be implemented in the law of countries and in guidance. And that you see here that the Netherlands did in 2018, that a new Dutch decree on the DP, but it was based on everything on BEPS from 15 and 17.
Yeah.
And that means that you have to look in every country, what did they implement, when they did it, they implemented, and how did they do it. So that makes the compliance burden even more difficult, because that could be that the requirements and the filing dates are not the same in the countries. And they are not.
More differentiation and also more stricter guidance.
But the message of this slide is BEPS focused everybody on TP. In 95, like I said, I had a question, what is TP? That's not a question anymore. So, and also the companies are asked to manage this. Yeah. Okay. Maybe next slide. Yeah. That's more general. So BEPS development. I think the first thing happened, reputation and fair share is entering the boardroom, because I think if you don't have seen it, maybe there's something to do on YouTube. Google, Amazon, and Starbucks were attacked. Also in a hearing, and I mean attack, because it was really serious about their tax position. And I believe the CEO of Apple said in the US hearing, that's also nice to hear, that he paid every dollar on tax he legally owes. And that was not the right answer at the moment, because fair share is entering the boardroom, and also with tax authorities. Then what you pay on tax should be also contributing to the country involved, and we see that a lot of countries are now looking into possibility to tax you with this kind of arguments. And you also see new law coming in, like the taxation on digital economy, which also is driven by this line. Another one is more on documentation and transparency. In the past, you could say, I tell you as a tax manager of a company, now tax authorities, but also others say, show me. And show me, you have to do to documentation. And documentation, that's the compliance burden, is the master file. That's the groups file, the bigger picture of the company. Local files you need for every country. So a local file is more than on the facts and figures of the local country. And country specific can be in. And in most countries, you have to file the master file and the local file for the country involved. And that is far more than in the past. Yeah? That means also transparency, because the master file of your company is not only given to your head office country, where it is resident, but to all the countries involved. And the local file is the local file for the country, but they can ask for the local files for the other countries. Yeah. And that exchange of information, that's the second one, is happening at the moment. And it is also on APAs and the country-by-country reporting. They are shared, like the Netherlands, an APA that you obtain in the Netherlands is not in itself shared as the total form, but in a short short description of the APA, that is shared by others. Yeah, yeah. And that's really happening at the moment. Show me and also share it. Yeah.
Yeah.
The other one is economic acceptance and harmful tax competition. I find that two sides of a coin. Economic acceptance means that you, and Narsen mentioned already, the BEPS action plan was geared that the taxable results should there fall where the economic value is created. And there was against tax havens because there was a lot of tax planning where the results were in a tax haven, and it's difficult to say that the economic value is created there.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore we invent the adequate substance is all on the table at the moment. And we will go into it later. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe an interesting question is coming in on the substance.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of companies, one of the substance requirement is that the effective management, the board decision should be held in the Netherlands, or decision should be made in the Netherlands. And of course, when companies have directors located in other countries,
mm-hmm.
they may now have some travel restrictions due to the coronavirus. Do you think that will be a problem for tax residency or substance?
That affects the two questions. What is substance? Eh? What do
yeah.
you need?
Yeah.
That's more general. That's always the case. And the second one is how to deal with it in corona times. Yeah? I think maybe the first one first, the substance question. I think we have in the Netherlands have an open norm about if you are tax resident, because I think that's the first question. Is you have a legal entity in the Netherlands, and is that a resident of the Netherlands?
Yeah.
Yeah. I think for that you need to have a place of effective management of that company in the Netherlands. That place of effective management, that's a board substance. That meaning that you have to have a board in the Netherlands that has board meetings in the Netherlands. If you come to a corona, because that could be a difficulty, board and make the decisions in the Netherlands. So don't do it outside the Netherlands and then fly in and sign it. Try really to have those meetings in the Netherlands and make also board meetings about it. That's important. That's one. Secondly, I think the economic conceptions also is going also more and more operational, because it is board level. That means on the operations that you have in the Netherlands, the activities performed, you need also to think about what kind of people do you need to be able to document that also operational. What are the activities in the Netherlands is performed in the Netherlands, and there we get some developments there. And what we see at the moment that most companies are trying to see what does it mean for me, yeah, and that all gets a lot of fields where you can have discussion on tax treaty benefits, tax residency, can I get an APA or not, and that's all about substance, and they're all a little bit different, so that goes too far with this discussion. Therefore, there's a lot of confusion. What is adequate substance? But the adequate substance, you have to go to are you a tax resident in the Netherlands? The second one, is the operational activity in the Netherlands enough backed up with Dutch people or people living in the Netherlands? And this is our items to be discussed and then to delve with.
Yeah.
I think one last remark, normally in the Netherlands, if you want to have a ruling, then 50% of your statutory board members should be resident for the Netherlands and also have a resume, which also say that they can manage it themselves. Okay.
Yeah.
A long answer. The second last question was on Corona. Because it could be that the board meeting can't be held because not the Taiwanese director, but the Dutch resident is. I have had last week a discussion with somebody who was stuck in India in a hotel room.
Mm-hmm.
That was a Dutch resident, board member of a Dutch company, and they held board meetings through, I believe, Zoom. And then the question arises: does it impact the tax residency? Because now the board meeting is not held in the Netherlands for a great part. Now, I think we can have a lot of governments will help the companies and will not start a discussion and more, maybe more formal. The OECD had guidance in the beginning of March stating that such problems at the moment most probably wouldn't lead to a change of tax residency. And I think it is good to see what kind of guidance is there and what the governments is important are describing about it. Sorry for the long reply. This is a topic substance which is really at the moment extremely important.
Okay.
Then we go to maybe last remark on the slide here. Shaming what I see, there's a lot of companies of governments now giving incentives to companies like the Netherlands. We have at the moment an incentive if your revenue goes down that you can have a great part of your wages of your employees paid by the government. Yeah? And Denmark refuses those kind of aids to a multinational when they have a presence in a tax haven. So that is really how it is done now in the media. No. Okay. Okay, there's something going on in my list. There are the questions coming in. Yeah. Okay. I will see in those questions, I think. There's a question about tax haven and how does it deal? What's kind of opinion on this and do you advise this kind of construction? I had some discussion. That's a good question. Thank you for that question. I think a tax haven in the structure can give you a lot of pain. An example, the withholding tax. If some we have since a year, new rules called CFC, controlled foreign company rules, that if you have a tax haven in a structure and dividends are paid to it or royalties or so, and you don't meet such certain threshold and substance there, then it could be that your payments to the country are not seen as payments, or even that you have withholding tax on it. As an example, there are more items to discuss. So what I would say to those multinationals, look for sustainable alternatives and see what's possible. And I think it's also the time to act. In the Corona times, a lot of such a crisis, I say never waste a good crisis. I'm sorry for this because I think we shouldn't have this crisis. This could be a moment in time to see in those structures and to maybe going into a more sustainable one. I now have one client supporting that's coming to the Netherlands just because of this reason. So my answer would be that this is the time to act.
And do you then also think, Theo, because I think for entities in tax havens, that do not meet the substance requirements, then it's clear. Then there are a lot of instruments and measures coming from tax authorities to tackle benefits in that kind of situations.
Mm-hmm.
But what do you think of a lot of multinationals also have the headquarter for the Middle East, for example, in Dubai. And for some countries, they consider the Dubai or the United Arab Emirates as a tax haven, while there is still a lot of substance to act as a regional headquarter.
I think some people still think that there are only camels in Dubai, but that's not the case. It's real industry there, a big one. If it is sound in economic activity, you have the substance. The buzzword is there again.
Yeah.
Then the problem is you can't get rulings anymore with like the Netherlands. They don't give you an APA if you are with transactions with the tax haven. And the tax haven there's a list which you can see into, and those countries mentioned are on it. Yeah? But that means that you have to document better.
So documentation is then more and more important.
Documentation is key there, because all the countries involved will, certainly after the crisis, when all the tax authorities and treasuries need money again, then they will try to seek if those rules apply to you, and then you have to have seen into it and have documented it so that you are safe, because that will be one important item in the future. Yeah. I was a little bit annoyed myself because that I had an APA request, and that from Dubai, that was the country, and the APA team in June 2019 said to me, formally, I can't give you an APA anymore. That was out of the blue from politics. So it was a politic discussion and nothing to do with activity or tax planning. Was not possible anymore.
Yeah.
Okay. I think we've taken depth of the list. Yeah, Corona. Yeah, cash management is key. I heard of a lot of tax managers at the moment also using NOLs of countries, because that's also important. If you have NOLs in countries outside the Netherlands, then try to also use them, because mostly going back with results is only 1 year. So NOLs are lost if you not use them properly.
Yeah.
Yeah. But also how to deal with stable results for routine functions, and then have Corona. And that could be that as a group in total you have a loss. But for a routine function, you need to pay that tax, because the cost plus still applies. Eh?
Yeah.
So, or the percentage of sales for a sales organization. And that led to the strange effect that you have taxable payments, cash out. And as a company in total, you have very low results or losses. And then the question can arise if Corona is sufficient justification to lowering these results routine. And the answer is no. We had this discussion also with the APA team. A Corona crisis in itself is not sufficient. You have to look in comparability if third parties would also lower them and document it. And that's also a possibility in APA, because you could have an APA with this kind of percentages, and now you are faced with it, how to deal with it. Now that's a discussion we can have, but in the mean, just saying Corona and now I lower results, that can give you problems.
It should be combined then with a business reason.
Yeah,
together with a business reason, then you will have some options, or what do you think?
A beginning.
Yeah.
You have to justify that based on all the factors to be considered, third parties, the effect also do it. And that could be on qualitative. I'm at the moment looking into all kinds of articles about third parties acting with each other, how to deal with the crisis. There was also the guidance on the OECD, what all the countries are doing to help companies on deferral of payments, etc. Because that will also be part of your documentation later, what you did.
Yeah.
So my answer is no, but it is a beginning. But there are a couple of concepts to take into account and document it, and then a lot is possible, even losses. But that means work. That work has to be done.
Yeah.
And another point of view is you have to do it now, because all those countries are going into the profits. You have your TP policy set at the moment, and you have to look at the moment, is my TP policy sufficient, what to document, and how to monitoring the results, because you don't do it in December, act at the moment, at this moment.
Yeah.
Okay.
And also with benchmarks to steal, for example, if you have a new intercompany transaction for which you would like to set the markup percentage, for example, a cost plus or a markup on sales, you will often do a benchmark study to test that routine function. And we then look at financial results of the years that are available in the database, but that are the years 16, 17 and 18, all positive years. Not the bad results of 2020 are in the database.
And they get a strange effect because we are used on benchmarking, and mostly you benchmark the results of 2020 with the results that are available from 16 to 18, and if you're lucky 19, and you don't get those results.
Mm-hmm.
But that's a problem on comparability. But I think we had the same discussion last recession, 2008-2011. Then we were waiting for the benchmark results for those years. And to our surprise, the markups were even higher than before. And so you need benchmarks, because that's in the documentation requirements. So that's difficult. But we saw at that time why, and because we were surprised ourselves. And the reason is, I think, that the company that are all in those benchmarks, you compare it with third-party companies. They're all standalone companies.
Yeah.
In the recession, the companies that were bad, quite results, were not anymore in the benchmark, because they weren't anymore active. And so the best companies stayed in the benchmark, and that got an uplift of the markups. I think that's a better reason, the documentation on the qualitative description, just mentioned the comparability factors, that are the most important one.
Yeah.
That documents that what you're doing is in line with third parties. Then we go to benchmarks. I think we have to have some solutions there, because that is more in how you, your strategy in deciding which company you accept or not accept as comparable companies. Until now, some loss-making companies are not accepted. And there I think we could have in the strategy, looking which companies to accept.
Yep.
There you can find real answers and support in documentation. So in the end, in summarization, I think you need benchmarks still, but there is some work to be done in that field, that you can really also rely on them and also document what you did.
Yeah.
So, and we do our own benchmark ourselves, so we will have a lot of nice discussion on it, Mark.
Yeah, so. Fully agree.
Okay, then we come to alignment with Dutch tax authorities. Yeah? Something I did for the last 20 years, working with the Dutch tax authorities as one of the APA leads, or also mutual agreement procedures or APAs. So that's my field here. And alignment with Dutch tax authorities is possible. We discussed that before. And I think the chosen approach which you would like to take there is depending on what your strategic risk management is. Do you want proactive alignment? Do you go in upfront? Because here I'm the company coming into Netherlands, of active in the Netherlands. I would like to say hello and discuss with you my case and what I'm going to do and what my transfer pricing design and for policy is. That's proactive. That can be informal with the local tax inspector, or they can be formal with the APA team. Yeah? That's proactive. You could also say, no, I'm waiting for the moment to document my position, the documentation. You file your tax return, and then you await what the reaction is over the tax authorities.
Yeah.
In the main, that are the very black and white, the possibilities. In practice, a very gray area there, but these are the one to the see into.
What do you prefer to you? Do you prefer proactive or reactive or?
That depends on the facts. It could be one or the other. That also depends on the risk appetite of a company and how they think about certainty.
Yeah.
But in the main, I think looking at the environment, I would choose for proactive alignment. Because it could be that you are in 2020 coming into the Netherlands and that you file your tax return in 2021, that they have questions in 2022 and maybe have an audit in 2024. And mostly they can go back 5 years. So yeah, with our environment, looking at what's possible, I would choose for that. And then the two questions, do you informal with the local tax inspector? Or are you going for a formal certainty, which gives you more certainty? Because if you go for an APA, that can be for 5 years. Huh?
Yeah, five years. Yeah.
So if you come in 2020, you can get it to 5 years in a row. And mostly when the facts and circumstances are similar, you can extend it for another 5 years.
Yeah.
Okay. But now we're coming to what happened, because that there's some change there to the international guidance on how to deal with giving certainty to companies. Yeah? The Netherlands was a little bit blamed because we had such a good APA practice and a good entrance to the tax authorities. And that led to some changes, but in the main, you have three actors that you can go to. That's the local tax inspector, who deals with your tax return and is the one that is responsible for the tax assessment. So if they follow or not your tax return, that's the local tax inspector. And that's the one. And next to it, we discussed the APA team, the Dutch ruling team. Yeah? That's in Rotterdam, in the Netherlands, a centralized team. And they have also now, if you go for granting an APA, they have a fiscal committee, which has to be in alignment with the APA. So that's a change. In the past, you had the APA team, and I was head of the APA team, so I could sign it, and that was okay. And nowadays, they have to go to a committee of seven people that decide as a second or third part of eyes on the application and if that's okay. Yeah. That's the ruling team, and next to it, you have the Dutch Knowledge Group for Transfer Pricing as a third actor. And how it works, they are the Dutch Knowledge Group of Transfer Pricing, mostly involved on transfer pricing in all areas. They could be helping the tax inspector by making a tax assessment, being an audit. They could be involved in supporting the APA team with the APA to be granted, etc., etc. So those people, in the Netherlands we have around 40 of those, are extremely important in managing your cases. So I was 7 years part of that team, and I think that that team is very important to involve in that situation if you think it is extremely important for you.
So in case you would like to have certainty, you have to go. You can go to the local tax inspector for the cases that, for the years that you have filed your tax return.
Yep.
So actually, for the past situations, simply saying, the Dutch ruling team you can go to for the future situations to obtain certainty in advance for the upcoming years.
Yeah.
And then the Dutch knowledge group is actually active in all the phases and will be contacted and be involved by the local tax inspector and by the Dutch ruling team.
Exactly. I have now such a case that at the moment where there is an audit going on till 2018, because the tax return is filed till that time, 2018. Mm-hmm. We went for an APA for 2020-25, and that means that all those parties are involved, and there's one key member of the knowledge group in all the phases.
Okay.
And if you manage that properly, then you can also really make this happen. Yeah? That's maybe if you go to to the last remark, managing the process is key. Normally what you see here, if you would like to have certainty or have an audit or whatsoever, the content is important. I'm not saying the content isn't important, but the managing of the process is important. And that is managing the thing, really having a good team and communication with the company, the tax authorities, with this kind of knowledge group, people of the knowledge group, that you have a reliable way of working with each other, and that you communicate well. And that is, I think, 70% or more of the success of a project. It's not only content and knowing the law, but also really having a way of having a good process and trust in the process with all the people involved. Yeah? Yeah. Trust is maybe the best word in this field. Yeah. I think that is alignment, eh? But yeah, for me, that's, I think, yeah, a no-brainer. Okay. Yeah, and then we go to the final remark in Q&A's. Eh? I got some questions here, but I think you were coming back to it later to not come out of time. And we know the people, so we are going to and Peter Young say thanks to Theo and Nacht. Let's keep healthy, keep cool, enjoy the family's time staying home. Hope we can meet in the golfing soon. Yeah,
that okay. Would be great.
That's another takeaway. And, I'm also golf a lot lately, but I'm very afraid of the people in Taiwan because they are extremely good golfers. And, I think the time will come that we can play golf again. Okay. The key takeaways, I think the first one, the Netherlands can be your gateway to Europe. I think we described it a lot, but also that we can also help you with all the problems that you're facing, eh? All the legal items, the requirement for tax, safety, pro-alignment, with tax authorities, proactive. That's all what's possible. Yeah? That's the first thing. Second thing is determine your adequate substance and TP design. I think that should be aligned with your business. That's the basis. But from that onwards, make that choice for your substance and your TP design. And that's an important one to start with. And I'll always say it should also be so simple, but you have to maintain it. It should be compliant. And then we can look us off incentives, but that's the way. Yeah. Other one is make use of the alignment possibilities. I think that is mentioned a lot in this webinar, but it's really the case. And the other one, and that's really also in this time, a lot of questions on it. Check on time if your current TP policy is ready for these Corona times. And why? Because I think there's a lot of possibilities to managing your tax, but then you have to document it properly. You have to look into your policy and make changes most probably in your policy. And my takeaway is that now governments are helping the companies. In 2 or 3 years, hopefully everything is okay again, but then the tax authorities will come to you and see if you what you did, that they can agree with it. And then you get a different role game. The last recession in 2008 and 10, we had so much audits afterwards in 2012-13, the whole BEPS action plan. And why? Because the countries need money, and this will be this thing similar. So do it. And if you change your policy, you have to adjust prices in the company maybe, or conditions, and do that on time. Don't do it in December when that could jeopardize all kinds of risk fields there, because countries see then that year-end adjustment, you can better do those adjustments on time. And last, you can also have alignment with tax authorities on it. We had with the Dutch APA team discussion on this kind of field, on what they would accept or not accept. And obviously, they can't give a black and white picture, but I think we know the gray area. Okay. That's us, I think, Narte.
Yeah, yeah.
How did you like it, Narte?
Oh, I really liked to do the webinar. I hope everyone and every listener enjoyed the session. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's actually all I want to say. And of course, stay safe in these unusual times.
Yeah. And you will get from us the presentation, the recording, also the presentation on the 15th of April. And please contact us in these times because we, like you, we're sitting mostly from home and it would be great to hear your voices.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, bye-bye.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.